standing, let's pray for our sister. Our Father and our God, we want to thank you this morning. Oh, we bless you that you have given us a minister of the word this day, dear Father. And want to thank you that this is the woman of God for the hour. We are opening our hearts and our spirits to our master. That God, you shall speak to us using our sister Naomi. And as you water us, water her too, dear Father. We pray for the grace and the anointing to serve in this altar. For we pray this in faith, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Praise God, church.
Amen.
Praise God again.
Amen.
As you've heard, my name is Naomi Theuri, and I thank God for this opportunity to stand here and speak to all of you. I'm very, very humbled. I'm representing the youth ladies, and I hope that you will be blessed.
Amen.
Just before I start, let me introduce my parents, Pastor Theuri and Pastor Monica. I thank God that he gave me such wonderful parents. So today I want us to go into the word. I'd like to speak about letting go and letting God.
Amen.
It's something that we've heard over and over again from all over, but I hope that today as I talk about it, you will understand and you will be able to finally let go and let God completely, okay?
Amen.
Let's go to the word, the book of Proverbs, chapter 3, verse 5 to 6. Proverbs 3, 5 to 6. In the New Living Translation, please. It says, trust in the Lord with all your heart. Do not depend on your own understanding. Please give me Message Version. Please. Verse 5 to 6. Let's begin with verse 5. Trust God from the bottom of your heart. Don't try to figure out everything on your own. Go on. Listen for God's voice in everything you do. Everywhere you go, He's the one who will keep you on track. Let's just repeat that. Trust in the... Don't try to figure out everything on your own. Listen for God's voice in everything you do. Everywhere you go, He's the one who will keep you on track. The Bible says that we should trust in the Lord with all our hearts and not to try and figure out everything on our own. Don't try and figure everything out on your own. But most times, we try and figure out things on our own. Is it true? We make plans. We say that in the next 5 years, which is not bad, it's good to have goals. But sometimes, we try to figure everything out on our own. Yet the Word has said, don't. The Word has told you, do not try and figure everything out on your own. It is the Lord that will keep you on track. We pray, most times you go to God and tell Him, God, I want this and this. I want it this way. I want it. You know, you tell God, this is what I want. This is when I want it. This is how I want it. And this is in the duration that I want it. Is it true?
Yes.
Is it true?
Yes.
Am I the only one who does that? I'm a tukoeni. Unaenda unaambia Mungu, next year, saa kama hizi, nataka kuwa na exactly this, exactly what we want. For example, in my situation, you know I'm still very young and I still go to school and have grades, right? So I will go to God and tell Him, God, I want a good grade. And I'll figure it out on my own so that God can give me a good grade. What I have to do is serve Him, you know. I will serve Him, I will pray and fast, I will read the Bible like never before. You know, that kind of thing. So that God can give me something in return. It's like someone once told me, it's an investment plan. You go and invest in God, expecting returns. Isn't it true? Most of you also invest, and you put something in to get something out, you get dividends, and And if it doesn't go that way, sinikubaya. It is not good, you get very disappointed and angry at God. And it is true. Like for me, in my example and my good grade, see now I have invested. See, I have put in my time. See, I have prayed and I have read the Bible. I have probably read it from page one to page last, and then I don't get that good grade. What happens? Remember, we are still in the scenario of the investment plan. I give something, I get back, and now I've not gotten back. It will get to the point where Nishasema, this God, I have done everything in my power so that he can do this for me, and he's not done it for me. So, story is, oh God, peace. Stuck each other. No, I don't want any more. No. And especially if it's something that you've really, really wanted, it's disappointing and it really hurts you because you've not gotten what you have prayed for. No. And we get so hurt, we get so down, probably you won't leave the house for days on end. We ask questions, we ask God questions, we ask him, what is the point of trusting? What was the point of doing all those things that I did? What was the point of even praying? Because it is what you expected that he will do. But now the problem with this scenario is we forget that we are not called to be God. We are called to be godly. Are you getting the point? Yeah. We're not called to be God, God himself. We are called to be godly. And God's in the sense that you will see what will be done, when it will be done, and for how long it will be done. Sindio, that is what, from what I have said. See, I was trying to be God, but we have been called to be godly. We are in conflict with God because we are trying to control things only God can. We are trying to control our lives, which is not, we are not able to do it. It is not in our capacity to control our lives. We don't have it in us. It is in him. So, and God, remember, God does not exist for us. Don't make that mistake and think God exists for us. We exist for God. Amen. He does not exist for us. He does not exist to grant us everything that is on our wish list. Like Umeandika, this is what I want. Come on, maybe in the States, the way they have Santa Claus. You watch the movies, and then the kids write everything that they want down, and then they give it to Santa Claus, and he grants them. Senior. But remember, that is not God. That is not how our God works. Our God is sovereign. We exist for him. We don't say and then he does. He says and then we do. We don't say that, I want to get this. We don't say, I want to get this promotion and now God, it's your task to give me this promotion. It is exactly him who says it. Like, let's think about a parent and a child. It is the parent who says, and then the child does. Like I can be sent by my parents right now, even maybe to go home, and home is far. Situation, it's very far. And I'll have to go because my parents says, and I do. But remember now, God is not even like my parent. God is sovereign. He is above every other thing. So he says we do. It is not that if we say he does. Okay. And we forget, most times we forget that this life is not our own. It belongs to him. He has entrusted us with it. If, for example, like this is my phone right here, right? I take it, I give it to probably Pastor Kaunda. Remember, it is my phone. I have given it to him. I have entrusted it to him. I'm still the one who will say how he will use it, when he will use it, how long he will charge it. I will say that kind of thing. What charger to use, what earphones to use, I will say all those things. Single, because it is my phone. Single. Now think about it this way. This life is not ours. It is his own. We have been entrusted with it. Amen. He says when it begins. He says when it ends. Yeah. He says where it will be lived. For example, where was it written that you had to be born here? If God decided you would have been born in probably Nevada or somewhere else there, maybe, probably you would be those people in Somalia. Because he's the one who says. It is not written. He's not under any sort of rule, that if there's someone above him, that if you're above him, now we tell him. And remember, this life is his. It is his. And another thing, when we give our lives to Christ, what do we say? Exactly what I have said. When we get born again, we go telling God and testifying, I have given my life to Christ. What are you saying? What exactly are you saying? You have given your life to Christ. What does it mean? It's not yours. You don't have a say at all. You have no say completely. Let's go to Proverbs chapter 16, verse 9. New Living Translation, please. Proverbs 16:9. It says we can make our plans, but the Lord determines our steps. So you can plan. It is okay. The Bible has said we can make our plans. It's okay, make a plan, but the Lord determines your steps. It doesn't say that he will follow the steps that you have laid out for him. It doesn't say that he will follow the plan that you have made. It says he determines. It says he determines our steps. Proverbs 19:21. The Message version. Proverbs 19:21 says, "We humans keep brainstorming options and plans, but God's purpose prevails." So we will keep on brainstorming. You will say, "I've not gotten this promotion now. I will get it next time." So you have brainstormed. You have made a plan. I will go back to school. I will get that extra knowledge so that I will be eligible for this promotion. But God's purpose prevails. So no matter what you do, his purpose will prevail. Because remember, this life is not ours. It's his. We don't see. And as I have said, we do not have it in ourselves. We don't have the capacity to run our lives at all. We don't have it. We're not even able. It is his job. And God is very good and he's gracious. He keeps on reminding us this over and over again, to the point that you will completely understand and you will completely yield. That is why he has spoken to me and I am standing right here. That you will remember that you don't have it in you to run your life. You will brainstorm all you want. You will plan all you want. But you won't say what will happen. God wants us to when we say, "I surrender all," He even wants you to surrender your dreams. He wants you to go and tell him, "Lord, this is what I have been dreaming, but I will let go just so that I may obey you and just so that I may please you." Because, for example, maybe a child from the age of 3 has been wanting to become a doctor. Let's use that scenario. And God's purpose is he or she will become a teacher. So no matter what the child does, no matter what school the child will attend, no matter how much she tries to read, she will still end up being that teacher. We won't say that she won't get disappointed. She will obviously get disappointed because it's been a long time dream, a long time goal. You have always wanted to do this. But remember, it is God who says. It is not us. We pray so many times that God's will be done. But can we handle his will being done? Ask yourself, can you handle his will being done? Most of the times we pray and say, "God, take control." We pray for all we want, alafu hapo mwisho tunamalizia na, "And may your will be done." Sindio? Can you handle his will be done? His will being done. Because that inability to handle his will being done is the reason we get disappointed. Because we have not gotten what we want. Because we cannot handle his will being done. But you need to get to the point where you can handle his will being done. You know, like that grade of mine that I really wanted was not his will. It was not his will. You know, and it is true, I really wanted a good grade, which I didn't get. So I'm speaking from a testimony, okay? I did all those things I've been telling you, those investment plans and getting rich, expecting return. And you know what I used to hold on to? In his word, he says, "No good thing will he withhold from those he loves." Nani wameona hiyo scripture? It's not only in my Bible. No good thing will he withhold from those he loves. Si anasema hivyo? So mimi nikafikiria nini? Is the good grade a good thing? Is it? Does God love me? He loves me. So 1 + 1 = 2. This good thing that he's saying in his word, and he loves me, he will not withhold. But then he reminded me that it is not a good thing in my eyes. It's a good thing in his eyes. Amen. options and plans. But then again, he reminds me, I must not waste my life trying to get back what God took away from me for my own good.
Amen.
I mustn't do that. But you know, all is not lost. As much as I have said, this life is not our own and we have no say, all is not lost.
Yes.
We still have hope. You know why? This situation is a good thing, a very good thing. A paraphrase that I read in Matthew chapter 5, verse 3 to 5. It's what someone read. I was reading in his book. He read and this is what he understood from it. We are blessed when we run out of options and all we can do is lean on God. Because when we realize our need for God, only then can we tap into his immeasurable greatness and goodness.
Amen.
Let me repeat. We are blessed when we run out of options and all we can do is lean on God. Because when we realize our need for God, only then can we tap into his immeasurable greatness and goodness.
Amen.
Only then. Not when I still have options. Not when I think I still have options. No. We are blessed when we are stripped of what is most precious to us. Because only then can we be embraced by the one most precious to us.
Yes.
And continuing on telling you that you're still blessed even if God is in control of your life, Jeremiah 29:11, the NIV version. We all know. Tuseme pamoja. Declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you a hope and a future.
Amen.
The Message version has also said he plans to take care of you. Meona, imekuja kidogo. You see, he plans to give you a hope and a future. Though it might not seem that way at that moment when you have not gotten what you wanted, he still has plans to prosper you, not to destroy you, not to harm you, to prosper you and give you a hope and a future.
Amen.
Joel 2:25, the New Living Translation, please. Joel 2:25, NLT. It says, the Lord says, I will give you back what you lost to the swarming locusts, the hopping locusts, the stripping locusts, and the cutting locusts. It was I who sent this great destroying army against you. It was him. You know, it's funny. It was him. He sent these things. But now he's telling you, I will give you back.
Amen.
I will still give you back what they have stolen. I still will.
Amen.
And see, we know that God's word does not go back to him unless it has accomplished what he sent it to. So he has saved it. What more evidence do you need? 1 Peter 5:7 says, I can just read it. Give all your worries and cares to God, for he cares for you. So you can give him your worries and your cares. He cares for you. That's the point. He cares for you. Exodus 14:14. This one I want protected. Let me see. Give me the New Living Translation, please. Oh, okay, Message, I'm sorry. Message, there's a point I want to see. God will fight the battle for you. And you keep your mouth shut. What else is there to say? What has he said? Keep your mouth shut. Quit complaining. Quit saying I didn't get it. Quit saying all those things. Keep your mouth shut and he will fight for you.
Yes.
Hasn't he said it?
Yes.
Won't he do it?
Yes.
Faith isn't the denial of obstacles. It is a deliberate effort. Deliberate. Remember, deliberate means you choose to do it consciously. It's a deliberate effort to hear God's voice above all other voices. There will be other voices, it is true, but what you will choose to hear is God's voice.
Amen.
Obstacles will exist, it is true they will exist, but as long as God has said it, the promise will still come to pass.
Amen.
Isaiah 30:18, the Message version. passage, please. But God's not finished. He is waiting around to be gracious to you. He is gathering strength to show mercy to you. God takes time to do everything right. Everything. Those who wait around for him are the lucky ones.
Amen.
A louder amen, please.
Amen.
He is not finished.
Yes.
He is not finished at all.
Yes.
He is waiting to be gracious to you.
Yes.
And he takes time to do everything right.
Amen.
Everything. Not giving me that good grade was not wrong.
Mm-hmm.
Not giving you that promotion that you've been waiting for was not wrong.
Mm-hmm.
Not giving you that which you asked him for was not wrong. He does everything right.
Yes.
In his eyes, it is right.
Hallelujah.
And it is about his eyes. It's about him, not us. Remember, about him. It will never be about us. Remember, we are a big body of believers spread throughout the nations, from east to west, from countries where you do not know they exist. There are still people there who believe in Christ, and we are part of one body. Not two, until the body of Christ is in Kenya, then now there's another one in that country whose name we don't know. It is one, spread out through everything. So you see, it's a bigger picture. It's not about you, it's a bigger picture. So probably what he's doing is for this, is we are completing something that someone in Nevada began. Someone in, I don't know, Saudi Arabia who's been killed, began. That is what we are completing. Because it's a whole body. And remember, in this place where you have not gotten what you want, so you're still discouraged. But as you, I hope you're getting the picture. You're getting the picture of letting go and letting God. It's becoming clear, right? We need to be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might in those seasons. That is Ephesians chapter 6, verse 10. Be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. And my investment plan, we still remember it, didn't you? That one for serving him, for praying, The Bible says, the only reward I get from doing all those things, the only reward is him, is God. Because in Genesis chapter 15 verse 1, he says, he is my exceedingly great reward. He is my reward. Not that good grade, not that stream what I have been wanting. He is my great reward. Thank you, Grace. This is a good friend of mine. She's called Grace. God bless you. He alone is our reward. Remember, it is not an investment plan. Even if you're looking to invest and get returns, the only returns you're going to get is God. And he is an exceedingly great reward. How many of you are getting, the Bible doesn't even say he's our reward. Not only he is our great reward, he's our exceedingly great reward.
Amen.
Exceedingly, you know that we all know the meaning of exceedingly, isn't it? And it is, I lack words. You know, when you try and describe God, you have no words, you lack words. I'm not the only one who suffers this disease. I can't even describe what kind of reward he is. I pray that he will minister to every one of you and show you that he is your reward.
Amen.
Nothing else but him.
Amen.
Isaiah 43 verse 18 to 19. NLT. Isaiah 43, 18 to 19. Forget about what happened. Don't keep going over old history.
Yes.
Be alert, present. I'm about to do something brand new. It's bursting out. Don't you see it? There it is. I'm making a road through the desert. Rivers in the badlands. Badlands, I'm assuming, are deserts. That was message. NLT says, but forget all that. Forget. It is nothing compared to what I am going to do. For I am about to do something new. See, I have already begun. Don't you see it? I will make a pathway through the wilderness. I will create rivers in the dry wastelands. That's what he says. Remember, don't go back to him until it has accomplished its purpose. So, wait around for him. Wait. And God wants our lives to be testimonies of his faithfulness. He wants our lives to be testimonies of his faithfulness. That means, probably, that. When people die, that's, what is it called? I've forgotten the name. This thing that you're usually given a person's photo. Eulogy, yes. When now that person is reading your eulogy, it's supposed to be a testimony of God's faithfulness. That people at your burial will have no choice but get saved. People at your burial will have no choice but trust in God. They'll have no choice but be encouraged because of the way God has been faithful to you. He wants your life to be a message to someone else. We need to have faith like that of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. They said, we trust that God is able to save us from this fire. But even if he doesn't, we will still believe. Let's just forget the rest of the story. We are at the moment where the furnace is being heated again 7 times. Saying that I want to be saved from this fire is actually a good thing. It's actually something we would all want. But you know what these three people said? Even if he does not, I will still trust. Yeah. It would have been very easy for them to go back and say, "Guy, your story is all God, 50-50 streak in your life. So let me just worship this God here so that I know my life is saved." Isn't it true? But what did they say? Atakama ni 50-50. Atakama sijui kama ataniokoa ama sijui hataniokoa. Mimi nitamtrust. I will still trust. The reference for that is Daniel 3:16-18. But even if he does not, I will still trust. Philippians 4:6-7, the Message version. Philippians 4:6-7. Message, please. Don't fret or worry. Instead of worrying, pray. Let petitions and praises shape your worries into prayers, letting God know your concerns. Verse 7. Before you know it, a sense of God's wholeness, everything coming together for good, will come and settle you down. It's wonderful what happens when Christ displaces worry at the center of your life. Don't we want to experience that wonderful? Yes. We do, right? So let us tell him all our worries and our petitions, right? But again, I want you to see deeper into this scripture. Just stop looking at the surface. Look now a little bit deeper. It says, shape your worries into prayers, letting God know your concerns. It does not continue to say that God will grant you your concerns. Does it continue to say that? Does it continue to say that all your worries, you will have nothing to worry about anymore? Yes, it's true, you have nothing to worry about anymore. But at that which you're worrying, the Bible does not continue to say that you will be granted it, that it will be granted to you. What does it say? God's wholeness will come down. You will experience that wonderful feeling of Christ displacing worry at the center of your life. Have we seen a little bit deeper into this scripture? What you're worrying about, it probably will not come to pass, but it is God that is going to come and displace that and be there at the center of your life. That's where he wants to be. That's where he's meant to be. How many times have we sang and said, we surrender? Mwashi, Pastor Millie said, they come and lead us. Oh Lord, we surrender it all to you. I give myself away, everything. Do you know what you're saying? Are you understanding what you're saying? Are you understanding what you're saying? Are you really understanding? The problem is that we don't understand the implications of saying that. We don't understand. Understanding exactly what it means. Are you able to handle God taking complete control over your life? Are you able to handle that? I need an answer. Are you able to handle it? We're supposed to be puppets of his will. You know, a puppet, see, it's lifeless. It can do nothing unless the puppet master comes and puts the hand in and starts making it move. He says when it will stand up, when it will walk, when it will say this, say that. That is what we are meant to be. That is what we mean when we say that I am surrendered. That means that you have no say at all in your life. No say. Until he says. You will have no opinion until he gives you one. Are you getting me? You will have no dreams until he gives you dreams. You will have nothing to look forward to unless he tells you, this is what I want you to look forward to. We need to get, this is a song I really love, it's called Trust in You. I'd like to read a few lines from it. It says, when you don't move the mountains, I needed you to move. When you don't pass the waters, I wished I could walk through. When you don't give the answers, as I cry out to you, I will trust in you. Doesn't mean that you didn't want mountains to be moved. You did, Cindy, that's what it says. You wanted some waters to be parted. You wanted some answers, but you have not gotten all that. But I will still trust in you. We need to get to that point where we say that and we mean that. You letting go of every single dream, laying each one at his feet. And you tell God, I have tried to win this war. I have tried to be in control of my life. But now, I want what you, Lord, want and nothing less. I want what you want and nothing less. And you know the interesting, see, I've told you God wants your life to be a testimony of his faithfulness. So do you think he will let you live a kawaida life, a life that people have lived so that he will be glorified? See, we know God wants glory, right? So he won't let you live a life that is easily lived. He will make ways where there seemed no way so that he may be glorified. When it seems it has come to a standstill, he will give you strength to climb that wall that he may be glorified. I probably want that child I was talking about who wanted to be a doctor. She will probably be a teacher like no other. A teacher that has never been seen on this earth. That God may be glorified. He won't let you be a teacher just like any other. How will he get glory that way? And you know the good thing with this situation is, as God is getting glory for you being a teacher like no other, a teacher who will probably one day become a president in this country, a teacher who will probably be placed in charge of education in the whole of Africa. It's probably a post that does not exist. But do we doubt that God can create posts? We don't doubt that. Still, he is more than able to do it. So, what you want is far much less than what God wants for you. By far, as in by far, less than what he wants for you, that he may be glorified. So what's the better option? You want to stick on to your dream that reaches here, and God's purpose reaches ukoju. What do you want? So you want that ukoju, but you remember there's a price to pay. All those things that you have been holding on to, you have to let go. Let go. And let God. Let go and let God. We should go to God as open books, as empty pages, asking him to write his story, that our histories will be his legacy, and actually mean it. We know idiots, right? Idiots. Watu wa jinga. Tunawajua. Sindio? Ladies, jana walienda mathari wakaona watu wa jinga. My mom was telling me, walikuwa naambiwa nani anataka kuokoka wanainua mkono wote, nani ameokoka wote wanainua mkono, nani hajaokoka wote wanainua mkono. You know, that is an idiot. No offense. But I don't even want you to look at it in an offense type of way. God wants you to be an idiot. Imagine God wants you to be an idiot. To be that kamjinga, that idiot. But in this case, not doing crazy things, just not doing anything until he tells you. That's the idiot he wants you to be. You don't know until he tells you. You're foolish, you're stupid. Until he tells you. Now what he says is what is wise. But what you think is foolish. That is what we are expected to be. And it is true. Okay, fine. You can make your list. If you want to make that list, fine, you are free to make that list. That long-term goal, that short-term goal, it is okay. Just, if you wish to plan, do this activity, it is all right. Just write down everything you want to achieve, probably in the next 1 week, but not now. The next 1 week, in the next 1 month, in the next 2 years, you know, that sort of thing, write it down. And then now you go, my CU patron in school taught us to, Mimi, his aunt who taught us how to do this. You know, you go with, to God with your list, senior, and you tell him, Lord, I want to let go and let you. I want you to have complete control in my life. I want you to lead me where I should go. I want your purpose for me, not what I want. Senior. And then you tell him, but God, just in case you want my help, just in case you want to hear what I want you to do for me, just in case you want, here it is. Joy. Just in case you want my idea, joy. But remember to mess up anini? Just in case. Naambia, do your will. But kama tu nataka kusikia vile mimi nataka, joy, just in case. Kibahati, kibahati tu, joy. Then you realize what that means. That your list will most probably not be followed. Juu tunasema nini? Just in case. His will is what will prevail. Remember that your goals are a just in case. Your wishes are a just in case. But his is what will prevail. Okay. Letting go and letting God is a very good thing. As I have said, you will probably not achieve your goals, but you will get to a place even better. Far much better than what you wanted. And I hope that as I conclude, I have gotten to the conclusion, as I conclude, you're getting the meaning of letting go and letting God. So, you know, we're actually getting what it really means. When you're singing, I surrender, ujue hapo, unajenga kwa kamfix. You know, but remember our lives are not ours. Even if you don't want to, he will still have his way. It's not ours, it's his. Ametupea tu akatuambia nishikie hii nitaikujia. Sana juni yangu nimekuambia nishikie utafanya vile nataka. That is what God is saying, and our job is to listen out for him. Listen to what he is saying. Because you will not know his purpose for you. You will not know what steps he wants you to make unless you listen. And you know, God is always speaking. He is constantly speaking, not only on Sunday, not only during midweek service. He is constantly speaking. So your job is to tune into his frequency. Get to that place where he is speaking from. Search for him and ask God, what is it that you're saying right now? Where is it that you want me to go? What is it that you want me to do? You're getting it. And he is constantly speaking. He will speak. All you have to do is listen and obey. That's your task. That is all you have to do. Listen and obey. That's all. And Proverbs, this is the last verse. Psalms 46 verse 10. Psalms 46 verse 10. New Living Translation. Proverbs 46:10. Step out of the traffic. Be still and know that I am God. I will be honored in every nation. I will be honored throughout the world. So just be still and know he is God. And he will be honored through your life. Okay? He will be honored through your life. Let's pray. Oh God, we thank you so much for this day. We thank you for this message that you have spoken to each and every one of us. Oh Lord, I pray that as we even live, like God, you will continue speaking to us, letting us understand what it really means to let go and let you have your way in our lives, oh God. And Father, may we live lives that will please you, oh God. And may you be glorified, oh God. Father, I choose personally, and we choose to let go and let you, oh God. Father, it is a tall order. But for you, for your sake, oh God, for the sake that what you have in store, for the sake of that what you have in store for us, oh God, we've met and met you. In Jesus' name I pray.
Amen.